So, it's 3 o'clock, so let's start. Welcome everybody to another version of the Online Holland Politics Lab. As you know, the Dutch academic year is brutally long, so June is a regular month for us to work. And to make that a little bit more bearable, we do continue with our Holland Politics Lab. And today we are pleased to welcome Loes Aaldring, who is an assistant professor at the VU University. She did her PhD at the Department of Political Science of the University of Amsterdam, went to our local, our Viennese hideout where many of us have been, and especially also some hot politics members like Ming Boyer have seeken refugee there. But she now safely returned home. She returned to the VU University as an assistant professor at the Department of Political Science. Loes's work has been funded by the NWO quite frequently, most recently on a veiny grant, and has appeared in journals like the Journal of Communication, the British Journal of Political Science. Today, she's going to present work co-authored with at least my two colleagues, Alessandro Nai and Katjana Gatterman, and a couple that I couldn't find anymore. They're floating around on social media, but make your own offer. And the title of the talk is Dark Side of the Mood, Candidate Evaluation, Voter Perceptions, and a Driving Role of Dark Personality Traits. Loes, the floor is yours. You can share your screen. And then for those of you who are new, you can type your questions in the Q&A box. And after the talk, I will read them out and then Loes will answer them. All right, Loes, the floor is yours.
Thanks. Let me share indeed. Can you see my slides? Yeah, perfect. Okay, so welcome everyone to this presentation. I'm very excited to be here. And indeed, I'm going to present a paper I'm working on with four others. So Alessandro Nai and Katjana Gatterman from the University of Amsterdam, and Frederico da Silva and Diego Garcia from the University of Lausanne. And we are in this project with the five of us, a bigger project on negative politics. So what we see is the tendency of politics to get darker over time. So more or an increase in effective polarization, an increase of negative partisanship, an increase in incivility and negative campaigning. And this is all coincide with the strong populist discourse and also an increase in politicians with dark personality traits. And if you think about politicians with dark personality traits, at least I immediately think of Trump. And I think he's one of the embodiments of dark. We talk about narcissism, psychopathy, and Machiavellianism. And I'm not the only one who thinks so. So there are a couple of professors and psychologists who also use him regularly as an example, as a prime example of somebody who has a narcissistic personality disorder. But he's not the only one. So Trump is, of course, a very visible example and very well-known example, but we see a lot more of these darker politicians or politicians with dark personality traits, of course, Putin, but also Orban or Bolsonaro or Erdogan, you name it. So we think the dark personality leaders are on the rise, but actually we know quite little about the influence of these dark personalities on voters. And so to what extent is this dark personality of politicians an asset or a hindrance for these politicians? That's the main question that we're actually discussing in this paper. And it relates very much to the main leader effects literature. And this main leader effects literature mainly focuses on the more regular leadership traits. So for instance, the Kinder traits, competence, empathy, integrity, and leadership, or strong leadership, and test to what extent performance on these traits influence candidate evaluations and vote choice. And the results are, this is studied quite a lot, and the results show that positive evaluations of voters on these leadership traits lead to a more positive candidate evaluation and an increase in likability to vote for these candidates or parties of these candidates, while negative leadership evaluations have the opposite effect. But these leadership traits are all desired traits, things that we want to see in our leaders. We want our leaders to be competent and have integrity and so on. So that's the main body of the leader effects literature. And this literature largely overlooks the personality of leaders. It mainly focuses on the leader traits, which is mainly based on behaviors of leaders and not so much on personality. Even though you could assume, it's very likely to assume that the personality of these leaders also affects voters. And when the personality is studied, then it's mainly focused on the big five personality traits. And in this paper, we take a different route, we take a different approach, and we focus not on the big five, but on the dark triad personality traits. So narcissism, psychopathy, and Machiavellianism. And these are all undesirable traits. And so in contrast to the leadership traits, we don't ideally want our leaders to be narcissistic, psychopaths, and Machiavellianistic, if that's even a word. So that's the main idea of the paper, to test to what extent evaluations of voters on these undesirable dark personality traits affect them in their candidate evaluation and in their vote choice. And we formulate two basic or baseline hypotheses, that if you score high on these dark personality traits, so if you have you're experienced as a strong narcissist or any of the other traits, that it is has a negative effect on your candidate evaluation and vote choice. Well, if you score low on these dark personality traits, it has a positive effect. So that's the baseline thing here. And then what we want to study is the relationship between this positive and negative effect. And we know from a lot of other research that there is a negativity bias. People tend to react stronger to negative information than to positive information. And we see this also in the political context. It is shown that negative political cues affect voters more strongly than the positive ones. But in this leader effects literature, this is only tested for the desirable traits. While we here think that, and there the empirical evidence is rather mixed, even though you would expect theoretically that the negative trait evaluations have a stronger effect, some find this negativity bias and some don't. But here, when we focus on the undesirable dark traits, we think that this negativity bias should be even more pronounced, right? So because these dark traits are inherently negative charged, these asymmetric effects should be stronger. So that's what we test in the third hypothesis, that the high scores on dark personality traits have a stronger effect on candidate evaluations than the low scores on the same traits, but then in opposite directions. So that is the main idea of the paper. And we test this combining two data sets. So the first is a representative survey of US citizens just after the 2020 elections. And the second is a survey experiment. And let me start with the survey. So what we measure here, the dependent variable is candidate evaluations of Trump and Biden, also with a feeling thermometer, and also as a robustness check, the vote choice for Trump and Biden. And the main independent variable is the perceived personality of Trump and Biden, and then the perceived dark personalities. So to what extent do voters think that Trump and Biden are narcissistic psychopaths and have Machiavellianistic characteristics. And we measure this with the Dirty Dozen dark personality traits measure. And of course, this is quite strongly affected by partisanship. Here you see the evaluations of Trump and Biden by party identification. And for Biden, you see a clear a partisan effect, right? So strong Democrats think he has quite low, he scores quite low on dark personality, while strong Republicans evaluate Biden as much more of a darker candidate. Interestingly for Trump, the scores across the board are quite high. So even partisans, Republicans, evaluate Trump as scoring relatively high on traits like narcissism, psychopathy, and Machiavellianism. But still, this partisanship, of course, plays a huge role in the way that both the candidates are perceived, but also how that affects their candidate evaluation and vote choice. So this is included as a control variable, as well as some economic variables, demographic, political interest, and some personality characteristics of voters. And if we run the models, we see, I lined it in red, the main effect, both with and without controls, is just as we would expect. So the higher voters, the stronger voters perceive candidates to have a dark personality, the lower their candidate evaluation. So the lower their thermometer score of the candidates. And we find the same effects for vote choice. So the more that you perceive a candidate to have a dark personality, the less likely you are to vote for this candidate. So this is support for the baseline hypothesis. But now we want to test the differential effect of positive and negative evaluations on these dark traits. And to do that, we divided the, we created two dummies, one for the upper third percentile of the distribution of perceived dark core for Trump and for Biden separately, and one for the lower third percentile. Percentile. So we take into account this skewed nature of the distribution, and then we compare relatively to other voters at the same moment. Do you still think that Trump or Biden scores high on these traits or low on these traits? And if we test this effect, we see indeed that, as we would expect, that those voters who perceive Trump and Biden to have a strong dark core, so to say, a strong dark personality, there's a negative effect, and a weak dark personality or not so dark personality, we have a positive effect. However, to test the negativity bias, we have to compare these results, right? So for Trump, we see what we would expect. The negative effect is significantly stronger than the positive effect, even though it's in different directions. But for Biden, we see the opposite, actually. So for Biden, the scoring low on the dark traits has a much stronger positive effect on candidate evaluations and vote choice than the negative effect of a high dark core. So there is some evidence for this negativity bias, but it's not universal. We don't see there are individual candidate differences that might be very important to take into account here. And of course, this is based on observational data. So the strength of the causal argument here is not as strong as it could be. And therefore, we developed study two, which is a survey experiment in which we use fictional politicians, and so from the independent politicians in the U.S. So to eliminate all pre-existing candidate impressions, but also to limit the effects or isolate it from partisan preferences. And what we do here in this experiment is that we manipulate the dark personality of the candidate and then test the effect on candidate evaluations. And we also test whether this is indeed mediated through the perceived personality of the candidate. So the independent variable here is the manipulation of the dark triad personality traits let me move this to the other side. In the in a newspaper article, we integrated that. It's a fictional character or a fictional candidate. We called him Paul Bauer, and nobody knows him because he doesn't exist. And we manipulate what information respondents get to see about the personality. And we cue the personality in two ways. So first, in one line describing the candidate by the journalist. So here, in this case, we have a positive manipulation, a strong narcissistic candidate. And we describe him here as Bauer has the reputation for being vain but self-assured. Okay, so that cues the personality as a narcissistic personality. But then we also mimic a sort of a mini interview with the candidate to get to know this candidate, in which the first question is a light one. So before we dive into the political topics, we want to get to know you as a candidate. If you could choose to be a fictional character for one day, who would that be? And the answer of the candidate also highlights this same personality trait. So in this case, high on person of narcissism, we included that this candidate wants to be James Bond and explain why and how that affects what he likes about James Bond. So here you see how we manipulated the absence and the presence of these dark personality traits, both in the text by the journalist and in the fictional characters that we have made up for the candidates. And we can talk about whether this, I mean, it was a lot of fun to design this stimulus material. And we think it works quite well to have these two cues, but maybe we can come back to this in the Q&A. And then the dependent variables, again, feeling thermometer, candidate evaluation, also vote choice, would you vote for this candidate if you were allowed to, and we control for the same things as in the survey. And what we see here is, again, support for the baseline hypothesis. So candidates that we framed as having had the presence of these dark traits, they have a strong negative effect compared to the control group, in which the personality of the candidate was not manipulated at all. So there was just described a little bit much more boring than the manipulations. And when the candidate was presented as having a low dark trait or the absence of these dark personalities, we see a positive effect. The positive effect is not quite robust to when we control for all these things, but because it's an experiment, you can question whether that is even needed. And if we put them together in a model, you see very clearly that the negative effect is stronger than the positive effect. So again, this is quite strong evidence, I would say, for the negativity bias. So the presence of this dark personality is much more influential for eventual candidate evaluations than the absence of this dark personality. And lastly, we tested whether this was indeed mediated through the perception of voters of a dark personality in these candidates. And that is the case, both for the high dark traits and the low dark traits. There's still somewhat of a direct effect left, but much of the effect is mediated through the perception of the personality of the candidate. So that are the main findings. So what do we think, at least, that we contribute? So we contribute to the leader effect literature by broadening the scope to focus more on personality and especially on dark personality. And we test the negativity bias for undesirable traits. And with the multi-method design, we try to take into account the problematic endogeneity of partisanship in this leader effect literature to isolate the effect as much as possible from that. So how do we go from here. As I said, we're in a bigger project on negative politics, and it's we have quite a lot of ideas. So I have to see how much time and money we have to work on all those. But the first one that we have collected data for already is a project on the Kinder leadership traits. The same, the idea is here to compare the US and the Netherlands, but also again combining survey and experimental data. For the experiment, we use the same idea as we did here, so queuing in two ways, by the journalist and in this answer. And here we linked the fictional characters all to Game of Thrones characters, and it was even more fun to come up with this stimulus material. So this is a project that is coming hopefully that we finish hopefully quite soon. And then, of course, these findings beg the question, so for who does this negativity bias work specifically? Both on the sides of the candidates, or which candidates is it relevant for or more pronounced for, but also on the side of voters. So which voters are more or less strongly affected by these negative or positive framed candidates? And especially if you think of dark trades, we assume that populist candidates, but also populist attitudes in voters, might be very relevant here, to take that into account. So that's the next step, to see to what extent populist attitudes play a role in how voters appreciate populist and non-populist candidates in terms of their personality and leader traits. And then there's a bigger project on negative politics, which is a comparative study on the more broad impact of negative political evaluations, also negative partisanship, on vote choice. So that's all hopefully coming in the future. I have some self-promotion here, because we're also working on a special issue on negative politics in politics and governance. Here's a link. So if you are working on a project that can be linked to negative politics and you're interested in publishing this in the special issue, please let us know. The abstract deadline is only in December, so there is still some time. We hope to collect a lot of studies on this interesting topic to publish together. Okay, thank you very much. That was it for now.
Thanks a lot, Luz. Great presentation. I kept on hearing this tune, this Star Wars tune in my head during the presentation. Was that sort of sent to me subliminally by the PowerPoint, or just me?
No. Yeah, it was you.
Okay. I wonder what that says about my personality. Okay, great. Let's open up for questions. And again, for those of you new here today, you can type your questions into the Q&A box. And Luz, you can also see the questions in this Q&A box, but I will also read them out. And while we wait for the first question to appear, let me fire a question immediately at you. I mean, I was very amused by your experimental material, and I absolutely think it is useful. I do wonder, can you reflect a bit more on comparing these rather different fictional characters? I mean, you're literally comparing a robot to an autistic person to pretty cool characters from films and series. Yeah. Have you pre-tested that? What are your reflections on this?
Yeah, no. So that's definitely problematic. Of course, we tried to are problematic. It's a challenge, right? So we try to come up with fictional characters that, first of all, as many people as we can reach know about. So they have to be quite famous, and really be a very clear representation of the character, of the personality trait that we wanna manipulate there. So. But there are differences. So the first cue is the same for everyone. We use different terms, of course, but there's always a positive and a negative component there. But the characters are a bit more difficult. We didn't pre-test them. As I said, for the second experiment, the leadership experiment, we tried to There we included two fictional characters, so one always from Game of Thrones. So that's already more comparable, right? And then if somebody doesn't know Game of Thrones, because that's also a risk that somebody doesn't know, we control for that. But we also included a second one that's also famous, with the hope that at least one of these is known. But we didn't pre-test it. We included a sort of manipulation check to see whether the manipulation for the positive and the negative is comparable. But that was also not very, very well thought of, because when we looked at the results, the negative ones were stronger, but that's also part of the negativity bias. So it's very difficult to come up with a sort of a test whether the negative and the positive manipulations are of equal size, to test that is not also affected by this negativity bias. So if you have any ideas for that, we are very happy to hear that. But for now, what we do in the analysis, so in the appendix of the paper, we also test for the specific trait dimensions. But in the main paper, the main analysis, we combine them. So we hope that in combining the positive and the negative ones, that at least equals out a little bit.
Okay, Bert, you wanted to add on to this? Or?
I was just about these film characters, because maybe it's because I don't watch enough movies, but to me they don't always intuitively make sense. And I wonder what the rationale was to include this second moving part in your experiment, which, well, the first part, like the descriptions, were very clean. Mm-hmm. The characters to me are creating a lot of noise, because I you know, the low Machiavellianism, I had no clue from which movie or who that was. Like, maybe it's me, right? Like, you know, but I think it's, as long as you cannot prove they're equivalent and seen perceived by everybody, it's creating unknown confounders in the experimental design. And I would be careful moving forward with that design feature, because I think you're going to run into critical reviewers that are going to ask you, like, well, yeah, the first part is equivalent, but now you have this weaker effect. Is that because of the robot, or is that because of this other part? Yeah. And I think a post-treatment manipulation check is not going to solve that for you.
No.
So I would actually be, also because Game of Thrones, right? I would pilot test it and only do this among Game of Thrones watchers, because you can fire anything on Game of Thrones on me, and I have no clue what you'll be talking about. Literally nothing. And so maybe I'm a weird subset of the population, but there's a fundamental issue of equivalence here. And that I think is the tricky part. You could probably get by in the first experiment by saying that it's a weaker treatment. But I also wonder if you would, like, one way to pilot test is to say, how would you describe this personality? But I wonder if people automatically would come up with dark triad descriptions. I think it's because you label it that people say, oh, yeah, maybe Francis of Underwood, obviously, that you would say, but would you say that he's also not a psychopath? You call him, is it just Machiavellianism? Is it also not narcissism? I think it's all three, right? So there's already the first part of the issue.
Yeah.
It was not a question, but it was more some feedback. There is a question.
That's super useful. And yeah, so we decided for the double Qs because we thought that one Q only by so the first Q only by the journalist is quite weak and is not, I mean, and
apparently not, right? If you look at your treatment effects.
Yeah, but now we think that it is because of the double treatment that people really sort of have a much stronger idea of the personality, because it matches with the first cue. But I mean, there it is definitely a risk of being less. It's much less clean, right? So, and we doubted a lot about And some of them are easier than others. And we were doubting a lot about whether to include the robot. I didn't know this whole robot, but we couldn't find fictional characters that all five of us knew and that are well known enough and that really are clear. But for this specific character trait, but we hope that we, even people who don't know, for instance, who Frank Underwood is, with the text accompanying why this politician explains that he wants to be Frank Underwood for a day, that still that personality cue is in there. And that one is made as comparable as possible. But there is, I mean, it does create some more noise than only the first few. Yeah. So yeah. Yeah. I'm gonna think about that more. And also, I mean, how would you whether this is equal over different fictional characters? We couldn't really come up with a solution for that problem.
Well, at a minimum, I think you should demonstrate that that if people think of these characters, they're also thinking about these personality traits. And I think that would be the minimal thing you need to show. I mean, they don't need to be exactly as strong, maybe.
And also not about the other personality traits, right?
Yes. So you could think about actually using character descriptions online, gather these and analyze them, or you could ask people to identify to describe these characters themselves, what they think of them. Okay, hey, there are questions. Also from people who probably are more familiar with films and series than Bert. You only read Siskus and Viscus, right?
Look at my bookshelf. Gonna make sure that there's some good books there. Okay.
Question from Tobias Rohrbach. Hi, Luz, super interesting project. What, if any, gender dynamics do you expect in how voters react to dark woman, I mean, he means dark trait woman versus men politicians?
Yeah. Yes. Hi, Tobias. Thanks. Yeah, of course, this is if we talk about for who does this work, both on the candidate and on the voter level, gender is a super interesting, is an interesting factor. I mean, I'm not sure yet how this would play out. I have to read more about that, but you could, I mean, because you also, you could argue maybe in two ways, right? That we would expect maybe a dark personality less with women and therefore it affects us stronger, but in which direction? That is a bit of the question. But for now, we only focus on men because it's already quite a lot. So here for this experiment, we had 7 groups. For the leadership experiment, we had 9. So it's already quite big. If we have to repeat that for both men and women, we couldn't afford that right now. But it's definitely one of the ideas that we in the future want to test, but to what extent gender dynamics are at play here.
So then you need to look for the female Frances Underwood.
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, for fiction.
No, that's Claire Underwood, so that's easy.
But for the rest, it's going to be more difficult to come up with these. Yeah.
All right. Let me say there's plenty of space for questions today. So please, type in your questions. There's a, there's not a question, but really... Katjana Gutterman writes that she's of course one of the co-authors. We control for the circumstance that they know the fictional character, but maybe you could say a bit more about that.
Yeah, so, so we definitely ask whether they know the character in the manipulation check that they saw, and we take that in the regression analysis in the as one of the controls, but only in a model that has these controls, not in the model the first model where we only test the manipulation. And from the top of my head, I don't know whether that's a fact, but that is at least taken into account. But that, I mean, that doesn't take into account the associations that people have with this fictional character, but only if they know them or not. Bert, you wanted to say something?
Yeah, there's increasing concerns that controlling for things post-treatment is biasing your experimental results. So there's the Nyan Montgomery paper in the AJPS from a couple of years ago that I see a lot at JEPs when post-treatment controls are included. So you because it's not randomized, right? So there might be actually also parts of the experiment that cause why people know the character or not, and then controlling for that is creating a post-treatment bias in the estimates. So I would personally be a bit careful of doing that. I have a question for you, Luz, because I really like this project. I think I'm writing a handbook chapter on personality and politics and reading up on the dark triad, and it's clear that it's a relevant set of traits to understand politics. Yet I have disconnect myself. I have a question about the extent to which we can treat them as a dark core, like a set of summated, like saying, I'm not sure how I understood the modeling strategy actually here, because should you say it's the dark, but like they correlate positively with each other, but it's how I understand the dark triad is not as if you're high on narcissism, that you're automatically high on Machiavellianism. So the question is, how much heterogeneity is there within these traits, especially in the experiment when you start actually have free manipulations tailored to the different traits? So should we not analyze that separately, or would an alternative specification not be to treat it as some sort of multi-level model where you have free observations of dark traits and control at least for if it's narcissism, Machiavellianism, or psychopathy? So the question, can you justify a little bit for focusing on the dark core as one trait versus that they are methodologically introduced as three separate traits that are positively correlated with each other?
Yes. So the honest answer there is that it also saves a lot of space in the paper, right? So it reduces or models by three. So, I mean, of course, substantially, they are three different indicators, I would say, of the same concept, overarching concept. They are directed, and they're equally in the same direction. And as you say, in real life, they are positively correlated, right? So usually what you also just said about Frank Underwood, he's Machiavellianism, but isn't he also a narcissist and also a little bit of psychopath? And so I think, even though they are measured differently in the survey, and also in the perceptions people have of this politician on these three traits are measured separately, I still think that we can analyze them together, because they scale very well and they measure one overarching concept. But you have doubts about that, we put in the appendix, we put all the separate analysis there for both in the survey and in the experiment.
I personally think that a multi-level model would do more justice to the fact that they're positively correlated but not one and one the same. Okay. And that would still be one model.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Let's go to a question from Matthijs Roduin. There are two questions. And I must say the first question, I agree with the first part, but I had a slightly different reading of the second part. But so I'll ask them both and let you figure out who you want to ask. So Matthijs's question, could it be the case that supporters of Trump and Orban, et cetera, actually like a little darkness? They probably don't want their leader to be a complete psychopath, but a relatively high score on these traits might appeal to them. In particular, because it contrasts with the opposite. A very friendly politician, for instance, probably seen by many of the Trump-Orban supporters as weak. And so here comes the distinction. So I was thinking along the lines of the concurrency model, which is used to explain why people of the same people like leaders with whom they share a personality. But that's clear that that's apparently not the argument you're making here. I'm actually not sure why, but Matthijs also writes here, in the second part of the study, you take into account the nonlinearity of the effect by distinguishing three categories, but just three might not pick up this possible preference for a little darkness. So his point is more people wouldn't prefer absolute darkness, but just around the mean darkness. And so would it be an idea to distinguish more categories to pick this up? That's the question.
Okay, so hi Matthijs, thanks. About the Trump and Orban supporters, yeah, definitely. That's definitely the next step to see what kind of voters respond differently to that, right? And we think that populist attitudes or right-wing populist attitudes are quite important in whether they like or do not like these dark personalities. And probably there will still be a negative effect of very strong dark personalities, right? As you say, guys, they don't want a complete psychopath, but it's likely to be less negative than non-right-wing populist voters. So that's definitely the next step. And this congruency argument, I think Alessandro wrote another paper about this, also based on the dark traits, in which he showed, if I'm not mistaken, that that indeed voters who score themselves quite strongly on these dark traits also have more tendency to like candidates that score high on these dark traits. So that might go hand in hand, but that's an empirical question, right? With right-wing populist attitudes. So whether voters who support these parties also have a stronger dark core, so to say, themselves. So that's definitely next up on the research agenda. And the second point, I'm very sorry, but I didn't completely get. So
I didn't read out the second part, but you were actually already engaging with it. Okay. So because that's the argument about the populism.
Okay.
So maybe the thing about having more categories.
So not for the experiment, of course, we cannot change it anymore, but for the survey experiment to have more variation in
how you cut it dark and
we now use this to have like a clear negative and positive side, so to say, from the mean point. Yeah, to make this comparison, but we could definitely test that. So that might be a good addition. I'm gonna write that down.
Okay. Then let's move to Patrick Stewart's. This is fascinating research, and I do agree with the difficulty of overlapping dimensions of the dark triad. But I really love the self-diagnosing approach. Have you thought of other ways that politicians might likely inadvertently reveal these traits to journalists or to voters watching them from a distance?
That's an interesting question. I don't know, we have to maybe think back of Trump. He was very in our face with his dark personality trait. So he showed it a lot. So we maybe should go back and see what ways he did it. I think, not only with a fictional character, but also with other types of response to questions, we could manipulate these traits. And maybe even in a more comparable way relating to the problem that Bert just highlighted, right? So, but it's difficult because, of course, nobody is gonna, we found it already quite daring to say, to let a politician say that he wants to be Hannibal Lecter for a day, right? And it still needs to be somewhat convincing, and we try to make that. But if you ask a politician a question and he or she responds in a way that cues normally a lot of negativity, that's not usually what they do. That's why Trump was such an exceptional case, because he was not hindered by that. But usually, I think, so we tried it first, I think, in answers to more to other interview questions, and there we run into the problem that it felt very unrealistic for politicians to present themselves in a very negative way, and that this fictional character goes around that a little bit. So that's why we chose for this. But I mean, it's an interesting way combining how politicians show themselves to be and revealing their personality. And I mean, probably there are other ways to do it, but this is what we chose.
Thanks, Luz. Patrick suggests maybe to look at humor, self-deprecating versus different types of ridicule. So I don't think he's talking about that these people are talking about themselves in a negative way, but rather they're bragging about some of their, you know, personality traits. And Donald Trump there is also a clear example. But while giving the answer, I was also getting more convinced actually about the stark difference between a psychopathic leader and a Machiavellian leader. Right. I mean, they would in many ways be actually exact opposites, in the sense that the psychopath would be much more intuitive and the Machiavellian a calculating creature. I just wanted to point out the irony of your paper picturing Machiavelli as an undesired leadership trait, whereas of course his whole endeavor was on describing how you should lead. And your co-author Alex, he actually wrote something. It's not a GIF. It's just campaign messages can provide personality cues: attack politics, low agreeableness, high psychopathy. Yeah, that's I guess there's some options here as well. We have time for a few more questions. I actually had a very specific question, but maybe it's a misunderstanding, that in study two, you have sort of the experimental component in there. But then you also run this model with a whole bunch of covariates, where also the individual dark trait items or sub skills, narcissism, psychopathy, appear, right?
Yeah.
And they seem to have quite large effects. So I was wondering if you could reflect on that, what that means.
Yes, I have to look that up a little bit. But indeed, we their control for the self. Evaluation of voters of their own dark traits, right? Yep. So this I mean, we haven't included this at all in the interpretation of the effects, but this would would control a bit for this congruency effect that you like candidates who are like you.
Yeah, but wouldn't it be a better experimental strategy to code concurrency? So you use the treatment and then take into account the individual characteristics and then code who is congruent with the message and who's incongruent. And that way evaluate, maybe that's a different study, but.
But it does answer a different research question, right? So I mean, then it is not so much about this testing this negativity bias in dark personality traits, but it's more like a congruence study. Do you like leaders that are like you or not? So I mean that if I understand you correctly, right? So that I think that would be interesting, and I think with this data we could test that, but
is the negativity implied? I mean, the negativity depends on where you stand as an individual. Right, so high dark traits aren't negative for someone who likes high dark traits.
Yeah, and I see that point with Machiavellianism, what you also just described, being strategic is also part of that, that you can frame as something that at least politicians need, right? But I mean, narcissism and psychopathy, is do we framing that as not as undesirable traits is quite a stretch, I would say.
Yeah, I agree.
Okay. Bert looks skeptical.
I have a question.
I don't know. I'm not per se sure if for high narcissistic people a narcissistic leader is something that is negative. Like it could be, you could actually argue both directions, right? Narcissists like to be in the center of attention. So do they tolerate other narcissists around them? Or do they, you know, I can be a narcissist in my little world and then somebody else can be that in another. That's actually an open-ended question. But I do think what I think your linear controls show in the experiment is that people with certain traits just have different baseline levels of reporting. That it's because it's a linear estimation. So controlling for the treatment effect, you show that narcissists are a little bit, in general, like people a little bit more or not. And by controlling, you remove the level differences. But it's not testing the congruency article. I would stimulate you to make it competing hypotheses if you, like, in a sense of you know, you can test the congruency argument here. Mm-hmm. Although I worry a little bit about statistical power but you have thousands of people, so you could probably do an interaction there. And then you could say, well, you know, is there a main effect or is it conditional on who you are? And what Gijs suggested by coding it as whether or not the treatment was more congruent or not with your personality, you remove the interaction. So that might actually give you a little bit more power. But that's, you know, they're just different explanations. And so there's two strategies to write the paper. One is like, here are our arguments and let's not, or say like, well, we there are two ways in which this could matter and test both and let's just see whatever shows up.
Yeah, I mean, I think we should definitely test that because we have the data to test this congruency argument, right? But I have to think a little bit more whether, I mean, we pre-registered this, so if we change that's also
like an exploratory, right? So you can still say, you know, you could even write it up. It's like after data collection, we also realized that we could test the congruency argument. Here it is, which would lead you to suggest this and that. As long as you're clear that you're not post-hoc theorizing, there's nothing, pre-registration is not preventing you from doing additional analysis. You just make a distinction between what you predicted and what you now come up. And you know, that makes, I think there's nobody that would have problems with that. And otherwise they're stupid.
Otherwise they're stupid, nice. And so you think this going into the direction of which persons, which voters like more or less these dark personality traits, based on this congruency argument, is a more interesting way to go forward from this than based on populist attitudes. Or, because we measured populist attitudes as well in this experiment, but we didn't use it at all yet.
I don't know what Gijs, I think you have a clearer theoretical argument on the congruency between leadership traits and personality of respondents. You can probably spin it towards populism, but I think that's just at best a proxy of something else.
I'm not a fan of populist attitudes.
No. Well, I try to.
I mean, scientifically, nice. You're allowed to have them, but the whole construct is to me problematic. But that's a wholly different discussion. I had one very short final remark responding to what your co-author Frederico wrote in the Q&A. I'm getting a very angry message now from Matthijs, by the way. Populism is the core. Yes, populist attitudes, Matthijs. Come on. Okay, sorry. Frederico wrote, if I recall correctly, the main reason why we decided to use a dark core was because our PCA failed to extract three separate underlying traits. So thanks for clarifying. Okay,
interesting. Differently,
I was just wondering, but I haven't read anything about dark triads except for Alex's work, really. I was just wondering, I mean, if this is really an established concept, then just a confirmatory factor analysis would suffice, right? We don't need to use an exploratory method for this. So that might be a solution here.
Yeah. Okay. It is a validated concept, and also the way that we measure it with the Dirty Dozen is, I think, as far as I know in the literature, a standard way of measuring these traits. Yeah. So yeah, that should work.
Yeah.
All right. We're at the end. Yes. Yeah. It's getting increasingly warm here, so I think it's time to call it a day. Thanks everyone for showing up. Bert will announce the remainder of the schedule. Yes.
Thanks, Luce. This is great. Next week, it's actually me presenting. I will present some work on personality and politics, a combination of studies that suggest that where personality has often been considered the causal driver of all sorts of political outcomes, I'll show quite some evidence that the reverse is also positive, so that politics is actually driving personality. And that should lead us to some bigger reflections on what do we know about personality and politics in general. So I'll talk about on next week, Friday. Then the Friday after, Gijs will talk about what do we actually know about psychophysiology and how to measure it and what consequences does that have? So we're in this existential phase of our life, studying big questions. So that's Friday 18th. And then the last Friday of the year, our academic year, is a graduate Friday where we have four interns from Brain and Cognition, which is a master at our Natural Science Institute, will present some of the work they're doing in the lab with Diamantis and Maike on EEG. So they're actually running people through. I think Maike was pilot testing in the lab this week, and they're doing their protocols in the coming weeks. So I think that's exciting, hot off the press work from some people that worked really hard on this. So I hope that you can also come that Friday, because graduate students are the hardest hit by the pandemic. Like people like Gijs and myself would enjoy it if you come, but we'll get by anyways. But the people, and these are actually not graduate students, they're master students. So come Friday the 25th, also come Friday the 11th and the 18th. But for now, it's time for beer.
And thanks, Luce. We forgot to thank Luce.
Yeah, you get a mug, Luce, obviously. And spread it around at the food, our competitors.
Yeah, person to actually receive the mug.
Don't overpromise, guys. Like,
I think I already have a whole bottle of mug.
Wait, did you earn this?
Yes. When I presented last year.
Oh, right. Okay. Oh.
Well, then you don't get
okay. Okay.
Yes, I have it here.
The hot bottle beer glass.
Ah, right.
Okay, then you can nominate one of your co-authors for a mug.
Thanks for having me. Have a great week.
You're welcome.
Yeah, see you later.